Good morning, students. Good morning, one and all. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, Neil sir. Neil sir, am I audible?
Sir, your voice is not audible. You are muted.
Yes, I am audible, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now you are audible. Now we'll begin with the session, sir.
Okay.
Good morning, one and all. Today we are gathered here for expert lecture on embedded and all RTOS concept. Today we are lucky to have Mr. Neil Madhav, who has completed his BTech from Nagpur University and MTech from College of Engineering, Pune. His core area is embedded system. He has completed his MTech in VLSI and embedded design in embedded systems. He is keen in a embedded system design. He is working as embedded associate engineer, in Entor Systems Private Limited, which is situated at Baudhan, Pune. And he has very good hands-on in embedded system. So we are lucky to have him today for this expert lecture on embedded system. So on behalf of Cusrow Wadia Institute of Technology, I, Shubhangi Kishan Verma, faculty of ENTC and faculty advisor of IEI Student Chapter, would like to welcome Neil sir for this session. Now I would like to request Neil sir to continue this session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for a great introduction. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So, hello, everyone. How are you? Everyone fit and fine?
Yes, sir.
Yes? Yeah. So, we will be starting this session. You can ask me doubts whenever you want. Please. Nothing like you have to ask me doubts at the end of the session. If you don't feel that you have understood the concept, you can interrupt me and ask me doubt at that point itself, okay? So it's it should be a good communication between you and me. And so let's get started, okay? So I'm now switching off my video and so I think my screen is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So we will start the session, Introduction to RTOS. So this session is just the basics of RTOS. We are not going into depth. We are not looking into C programming codes, okay? We are just looking into the basic theoretical concepts which are included in RTOS, okay? So first thing, what is RTOS? So full form is real-time operating system, and there are a lot of operating systems present with us, like batch operating system, multi-threaded operating system, distributed operating system, clustered operating system. So RTOS is also one type of operating system, okay? And RTOS is extensively used in embedded system. It is also used in different applications as well, but it's extensively used in embedded systems. And main function of RTOS is time constant. So RTOS is a very time constant operating system. So that means everything is related to time. For example, if you look into YouTube videos, right, all of you look YouTube videos. And in YouTube videos, there are two types of videos. One of the videos that are already stored and another videos are live stream. Like right now, what we are communicating is live stream, right? Now in live streaming, the delay with time is of very much importance. And it is not preferable or it is not advisable that in the live streaming, there is a lot of delay. So there is some time constraint in live streaming, but when the videos are stored in YouTube, there is no time constraint. So this is like basic analogy what real-time operating system is. And there are two types of RTOS. One is hard RTOS and one is soft RTOS. And as name suggests, hard RTOS is simply, which is heavily time critical. Okay. For example, missile systems or satellite systems. So these are very time critical applications where any variation in time can lead to a disastrous solutions. Okay. So that's why hard RTOS is mainly used in satellite communications as well. Okay. And second one is soft RTOS. So soft RTOS is like YouTube. YouTube live streaming also, if there is some delay in streaming, like 1 second delay, 2 second delay, that will not be a hazardous situation, right? In hard RTOS, like missile system, if there is a delay of 1 second, it can lead to a disastrous solution. But in soft RTOS, even if there are some delay, and it is based on application, okay? It is based on application, how much delay you can, it is advisable and all that. So even in RTOS, there are RTOS is used in different applications and different scenarios, okay? So this is the basic what RTOS is. Now, in operating system, one concept is what is kernel. And before going into kernel, benefits of RTOS is RTOS has good reliability. Okay, it is very reliable also, and what I can say, it has it increases the performance of the task that you're using. Okay. So now, what is kernel? Now, if you look into this diagram is basic kernel diagram. Okay. Now there are hardware, system call interface, and user written application and Unix commands. The main purpose of kernel is to communicate between hardware and application interface. Okay. So, for example, all of you are watching this session on laptop. Now, in laptop, what are hardwares? The keyboard, the touchpad, USB, your microphone, your screen, these all are hardwares, and each and every hardware consists of their hardware device drivers. Okay. Now device drivers means, suppose you have inserted some different hard disk on your laptop, so it needs to install some drivers so that it works, right? So that drivers are known as device drivers. So hardware consists of different type of device drivers. And application cannot directly access those device drivers. It has to access it through kernel. Okay, so there are some system calls. For example, you have to open a folder in your computer. Now, what do? You double click on the folder and the folder opens. Now in background, that does not happen, okay? In background, a code is written that if you double click on the folder, fopen of system call function is called. Now what does this fopen will do? Fopen will go to that specific folder name. From that folder name will have some address in your hard disk, okay? Now in it will go and it will do that memory access. And after that memory access, it will read and then it will display that content on your screen. So this is the background process that happens, and for all those things kernels are used. Okay, and there is one more, you can see here mode bit zero. What this means now, in operating system there is a bit named as mode bit. If you write a code, mostly there are two types of modes. One is user mode and one is kernel mode. And this is a simple integer where the operating system switches between user mode and kernel mode. So if it is in user mode, mode bit is 1. If it is in kernel mode, mode bit is 0. So operating system always access that mode bit and accordingly it functions. Okay, so generally mode bit is made 0 for kernel, but it is just an integer, it can be varied. Okay, so again insist, if there are any doubts you can interrupt me whenever you want. Okay, and I hope no one is watching YouTube. I hope so. Now this is something, an important topic, and I want all of you. So before this, everything was very basic, okay, but this process state is little bit important, so I want all of you to have little focus right now, and if there are any doubts please ask. So in process state, this is secondary memory. Now what is secondary memory? Your 1 TB memory, your hard disk. Okay, now this secondary memory consists of many things: your games, your videos, music, images. There are a lot of things in your secondary memory. Okay, these all things like images, your videos, your files, everything can be considered as a process. If you open an image, that is a process, that is a task. Okay, that the processor has to perform. So this is secondary memory. Now suppose you want to open a file, or if suppose you want to open an image from your hard disk. Okay, now that image is present in your hard disk. You open that image. When you click it, it goes here, new. New means it is going to be opened. It is the process is going to start to open this image. Now here I am assuming that this is a single process, single processor, single core processing technique. This is not multi-core, not multi-threaded. So it is very assume that this is very old system where only one process can be executed at a time. So that you can actually understand how process works. Okay. So this is very simple technique, and at the present computer power, this does not happen. Lot of parallel processing takes place, but each and every parallel processing works in this similar technique, this similar way. Okay, so that file needs to be opened. Now first that file will be copied to the RAM, random access memory, the fast memory. Okay, the secondary memory is slow memory, so it has space of 1 TB and it is slow. RAM is a fast memory. You have RAM of 4 GB, 8 GB. So it is a fast memory. So first work will be to copy that task, that copy the process, copy that image to the random access memory. This is known as allocation, allocation of addresses. So suppose your RAM has 4 GB of memory. Okay. Now if it has 4 GB of memory, it has some addresses to each and every memory. So one of that address will be given to that this image. Okay, you can calculate it. 4 GB is equal to 2 to the power x. Okay, then what is the value of x? You can do it by log base 2 of 4 GB. Okay, so you can get the value of x, and accordingly that much address space, addresses are available in the RAM. Now one of this address is given to that image. Now this is in ready state. Now there are many processes in the secondary memory. Okay, Like for example, even if you click on the image, in the background, your screen should work, right? Your screen should display, your keyboard should work, your touchpad should work. So these are some processes that needs to work in the parallel with the image, okay? So this all processes are in queue in this ready state, in queue, like 1, 2, 3, 4, it is in queue, right? Like a data structure. Now, when this image needs to be needs to work, it goes into running state. It is scheduled. The image is scheduled to go to the running state. Okay, and there it completes it for all the work, and then it goes to deallocation. Deallocation means deallocating the addresses present in the RAM. So RAM is 4 gigabytes. It is fixed. Now, if suppose an image requires 500 MB of the data, the 500 MB is copied in the RAM. Now, if more processes will come, the RAM will get filled up. So first the addresses are allocated and then they are deallocated so that different processes can again come back. Okay. Now, suppose the image is running. It is in a running state. Before even displaying it to the screen, one more process comes, which is very, which is of high priority. Okay. Now, when that process comes, the processor will tell that image, that process, to go back to the ready state, go back to the queue. I will first perform that high priority task, and then when that task is completed, I will give access to it. Okay. So, so it will go back to ready state. So this is known as priority schedule. Okay. Now second is time quantum also. Suppose there are some scheduling mechanisms in which times are defined. Okay. For example, process A in the matter of fact, any process will work for only 2 seconds. And after that, I will switch to different process. Okay. So there are suppose process A, process B, process C. Process A will work for 2 seconds. Even if it is not completed, the processor will switch back to process B. It will try to complete it in 2 seconds. If it is not completed, it will switch back to process C, and then again switch back to process A till it is completed. So this is also known as time quantum. So time quantum scheduling is also a very common method. And then there is deallocation. Now suppose you have opened a file, and that file needs to access your secondary memory. Now that file is in RAM. Now that process requires some reading of secondary memory. Okay. Now for that case, the secondary memory is very slow. Okay. So processor cannot wait till the all the data is accessed or data is read or data is write. Okay. So in that case, the process goes into wait state. And it waits till the input-output operation is completed. And when this input-output operation is completed, it again goes into the ready queue. And then the scheduler will schedule based on the priorities which process has to be completed. And then again, it will be deallocated. So this is the basic method on which how process states. Now, I want, if anyone have any doubts, please tell me. So, because this is something little complex, I think. Maybe someone of you have know it, some of you don't know it. So if there are any doubts, please clear it right now. Anything?
Students, if you don't have any doubt, then say, sir, everything is clear. Okay, if you have any doubt, you can ask him. You can reply in chat box or you can unmute your device and answer the question. So up to this, everything is clear?
Yes, sir.
So if there are any doubts, please ask. Okay, so process states is completed. process and threads. So again, it is little bit more into depth. What are processes and what are threads? So first we will look into these images. Okay, don't look into these differences. First look into these images. The left image, this image is of process. Okay, and this right image is of thread. Now, what is the process? Process consists of, look at this, data, files, register, stack, and a code. So for example, this is process A. Now, if I have one more process here, process B, what will it have? It have data, files, register, stack, and code. But the data, files, register, stack, and code of process A will be different than process B. Process A and process B are mutually exclusive to each other. They are not correlated. Okay. Similarly, if there is a process C, it will have a different data, files, register, stack, code than process A and process B. Okay, now you go to threads. Now you can see here, it has, this is, you look into this, this looks like a process, right? It has a data file, but there are three threads here. Each thread has their individual registers and stack. Okay, each thread had individual register and stack, but it has common data, files, and code. So this is a basic visual difference between a thread and a process. A process consists of data, files, register, stack, and code. Threads consist of a common data, files, and code, and individual registers and stack. Okay. Now what? So what will happen? So look, the first point I have already explained, that different processes have different copies of data, code, and stack. Threads have same share of copy of data and code. They have individual stack and registers. Okay. OS treats different processes differently. So process A, process B, process C are mutually exclusive to each other. Operating system will treat each process differently. Okay. There may be a case when process A and process B are interlinked to each other, but only at that interlink, particular point of time where process A need to access process B or process C, at that time only they will interact with each other. But still, operating system will treat each and every process individually. Now, threads. All threads inside a process is considered as a task. So this all thing is a single task and it consists of three threads. So process operating system will treat this whole thing as a single process or as a single task. And that single task consists of three threads. Okay. Now system calls are involved in form. Now system calls means kernel. The process directly communicates through kernel. Kernel directly communicates with hardware through operating system. So directly system calls are involved in process. So a system call known as fork. So fork is generally used for creation of child processes. So suppose you have a process A having data, file, register, stack, and code. And in the code you write fork. So again, child process is created consisting of same data, files, register, stack, and code, a copy of them. You can then change it accordingly what that second process should work. But this fork is a system call used to create processes. Now in threads, there are no system calls involved. There is a library known as pthreads.h. Like in C, you have standard input output, standard lib.h. Similarly, there are pthreads.h. That library is in user mode and not in kernel mode. So threads work in user mode and process work in kernel mode. Okay, now in thread, pthreads.h consists of different APIs like threads create. You can create threads, you can delete the threads, you can log the threads. So there are some APIs involved, but they are not system calls. Okay. Process has context switching slower. Why? Because each process will have different addresses and all the addresses needs access time will vary. Okay, and it will take much more time compared to threads where data files and code are common, and each thread will have the address that is already present inside the code. So threads addresses are already present, so to access each and individual thread, it will be very easy. So context switching is faster in threads and context switching is slower in process. And again, suppose there are process A and process B. If I block process A, process B will still work. But in threads, if there are three threads, if I block thread one, whole process stops. So even if one thread is not working, whole process stops. So it is better to remove the thread. If thread is not working, remove the thread, you will have only two threads. But if you have a thread and you block that thread, whole process will stop. Okay. So this is the basic difference between process and threads. So any doubt till now? So we will now move to semaphores and mutexes. So if there are any doubts, please ask me anytime. So semaphores and mutex. So first we will look into people door analogy. So first I will go to a notepad. So suppose there are three people. Okay. Wait, there are four people. Hello. So there are four people, P1, P2, P3 and P4. Okay. And there are three doors, D1. And there is key equal to 3. This is a people's door analogy. So there are four people which needs to access these three doors. You can assume these doors as washrooms. So there are four people which needs to go to washrooms. D1, D2, D3 are washrooms. Okay. Suppose first P1 gets the access to washroom. It goes to D1 and it P1 first takes the key. There are three keys available. It first takes the key and then it goes to D1. So when P1 takes the key will reduce to 2. Okay. Then P2 gets the access to D2. Then key will be reduced to 1. Then P3 gets the access to D3 and key will be reduced to 0. Now there are no keys and still P4 needs to go to the washroom. D1, T2, D3 are fully occupied. P4 has to wait till either P1, P2, P3 releases the key. Okay. For example, P2 completes its work inside the washroom. So what he's doing inside washroom is of no concern to us, but it completed its work. And now P2 releases the D2. P2 release the key. So now key will be incremented to value 1. And now D2 is free. And now P4 will go to D2 and key will again to 0. You are getting this point. What is happening here? So what I am doing is, there are three. Suppose these are four processes, and these four processes needs to be executed simultaneously. And to do that, we are using a word known as key to give access to each and every processes. And processes will work only if key is free, else it will not work. Now when key is 0, even if there are process P5, it has to wait. P5 has to wait because key is 0. It cannot work because the D1, D2, D3 is fully occupied and key is 3. So this is semaphores. This whole thing is semaphores, okay? For this key is a semaphore. This is a basic analogy how you can understand semaphores, okay? So here semaphores are signaling approach. It allows number of threads to access shared resources, okay? So this is a signaling approach. And it these are shared resources D1, D2, D3, and processes are allowed to share this D1, D2, and D3. We will look into deep in semaphores. Now, first semaphores is done. Now we will look into mutexes. Now suppose there is only one door. Okay, and there are no keys, and there are five people. What will happen? So this is a terminology for semaphore. I will remove it. Now suppose P1, P2, P3, P4, P5. There is only one washroom, and everyone wants to go to the washroom. तब क्या होगा? अब झगड़ा होगा. जिसको जिसको भैया ज़्यादा pressure लगा, जी उसको जल्दी जाना. So there will be a chaos. So how it will be managed? So what it will do, suppose P2 wins the fight and P2 gets the access to D1. Okay, so first it will block the D1. Okay, this is my D1, I will be using it. P1, P3, P4, you keep on fighting. Now I am using the D1. And P2 will complete all its processes. And then it will unlock T1. When it unlocks, then again P3, P4 and P5 are eligible to access D1. And according to the scheduling mechanism, maybe priority or round robin or any scheduling mechanism, for example, P4 will get the access. So this process will keep on continuing till all the processes completes its work. Okay. So this is lock and unlock, and this is known as mutex. Okay, so you understand semaphores have keys and these mutexes are lock and unlock. So I think all of you understood the analogy. So mutex is a lock based approach, and semaphores are signaling approach. This is log based approach, and only one thread is allowed to access the resource. Okay, so one thread is allowed to access the resource. It will lock the door, and it will complete this process, and then it will unlock it. Okay. So what is a semaphore? Semaphore is completely a variable. Like I showed you, key is equal to 3. That is a semaphore. Okay. Now, when you write a semaphore in C language, there is two terminology like P and V. P means wait, sleep, and down. If you remember the analogy, when the P1 get access to D1, the key was reduced from 3 to 2, right? The key value was reduced. So that is done by P, wait, sleep, or down. And when P2 completes its process and key was 0, it releases the key. So key was incremented from 0 to 1, right? And then P4 got the access. That is VS, that is signal wake up and off. So it incrementates the key. So this is like two, you can say a function inside semaphore, which decrements the key and which increments the key. So this can be implemented in C language, okay. So what, there are two types of semaphores. One is counting semaphore and one is binary. The analogy which I showed you, that was counting semaphore because it has values 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay. And generally semaphores less than 0 is not used, but the value of key less than 0 is not used, but it can be used also. And the second one is binary semaphore. So the key value will be 0 or 1. One means the key is there, you can access the resource. When key is equal to 0, you don't have the key is 0, you cannot access the resource. So it is binary semaphore is very much similar to mutex. Only lock and unlock is not there, but the process is same. Like key, when key is one, only one process can be accessed. Okay. So this is semaphore, and the next is mutex. So this is like a pseudo code in mutex. Okay. So suppose there is some code you have written in C. Now you have to go to critical section. For us, critical section was going into washroom. Okay. So first we will lock the washroom. We will go to the critical section. We will complete our critical process. Then we will unlock it, unlock the washroom, and then again we will move forward. Okay. So any process needs to complete its work. It will first lock that critical section and then it will unlock it. So this is how mutex works. And this can be implemented in C language. This is a basic introduction to RTOS, like a theoretical concept. That's why I'm not showing you the C code, but this all things are implemented in C language. So I recommend all of you to look into semaphores and mutexes C code and try to understand it and try to learn C language thoroughly, because if you want to have a career in embedded systems, C language is of vital importance. So without C language, you cannot do anything. It's not important to learn Python or C++, but basic C is of very much importance, because all RTOS operating system, all coding is done in C. So this all mutexes, all semaphores, all processes, which everything I have discussed with you till now, is implemented using C language. You cannot even use Python in doing this. Okay, you cannot even do that. So if there are any doubt in semaphores and mutex, please ask. So these two topics, process states, process versus thread, semaphores and mutex. This is very important topic. Even if you go for any interview and if you say you know RTOS, they will ask you what is semaphores and mutexes. They can even ask you write the code for semaphores and mutexes. So these are like very basic things and very important things, and it is still used. So if there are any doubts, you can ask me. So I will move forward. Now, so the little bit of what I can say, conceptually heavy stuff is already completed, I can say that. Now we will go to inter-process communication. So suppose there are two processes and we need to communicate between two processes. Okay. So how we can, now why we need to do communication? For synchronization, suppose process A and process B needs to work together. For example, process A needs to access some data from process B, and process B needs to give data to process A. So for that, a communication mechanism has to be made. And that is known as inter-process communication, IPC. Okay, so one of the methods of doing inter-process communication is mailboxes. Okay, so what is mailbox? Mail means for two processes to exchange information. Okay, it's just, what is a mail? What you do with email, you just write your email, you give the email ID, and you press the send button, the mail is sent to the desired receiver. So mailbox is of same method. Its work is to exchange information between two processes. So indirect addressing is used. So what does indirect addressing means? Direct transmission of data from sender to receiver is not done. For example, process A and process B needs to communicate with each other. That does not mean, suppose process A wants to send data to process B. That does not mean process A will directly send data to process B and process B will receive that data. It does not happen that way. It happened indirectly. Okay, so there is a data structure, a queue, a common shared data structure is there. That data structure is shared between process A, process B, process C, an n number of processes. Okay, that shared data structure will be communicating with each and every process. So now, if process A wants to communicate to process B, if process A wants to send some data to process B, process A will first send the data to that shared data structure, the shared queue. And then that process B will collect that data from that queue. So this is how mailbox works. So a shared data structure is there and communication happened with that shared data structure. Direct communication does not happen. So in mailboxes, there are like one-to-one communication, like process A communicates with process B. This is, even if it's copied to the data structure, the queue, it is still a private communication because process A and process B, no one knows what are they communicating. Okay, so this is one-to-one communication. Second is many-to-one communication. There are many, it's like clients and server type of thing. There are many clients, there is a single server, okay, and you are communicating directly to the server. For example, cloud-based programs. Suppose you are saving some data in your Google Drive. Now Google Drive will be located in one of the servers in Google. Okay. So what is happening? In the Google, there is a server and you are a client. And there are many clients over here. And there is a chance that single server will have a lot of clients. Okay. So it's many to one communication, like server communication. Okay. One to many communication like broadcast, FM radio, AM radio. One process send the data to the queue and the process B, C, D, E, F, all are copying that data to themselves. So this is one to many communication. Many to many communication are simple. There are many servers and many clients and they are communicating with each other. So with the visual perspective, you can look like this, it's like one to one communication is a mailbox, one to many, look in here, port. So whenever there is a client and server type of thing, mailboxes are denoted as port. They are the terminology of mailbox is converted into ports. Okay. So this is server-based communication. Then there are one-to-many communication, and this is many-to-many. So this is how a visual perspective to show you how different types of mailboxes work. Okay. Then there are message queues. So message queues are again a type of inter-process communication. So inter-task communication. It is task and processes can be interchanged. Some of the operating system have different meaning of task and processes. Some operating system use task and processes interchangeably. Okay. So right now, if I'm telling you inter-task, that means inter-process. Task and processes are same. Okay. So message queues is like used for inter-process communication. Now FIFO, LIFO, PRI can be followed. FIFO like first in, first out, last in, first out, and priority interrupts. So these are like some scheduling mechanism. Round robin is also a scheduling mechanism. Fixed priority is also a scheduling mechanism. These are the mechanisms that can be followed. Okay, for message queues. So what message queues consist? So message queues consist of control block to control the data. It consists of the name. It consists of ID. ID is just a like your address. It's not typically an address, but it is a unique identification of that data. Okay, that data. So the ID, then there is a memory to store the data, length of queue. Length of the queue in which you have copied the message, length of the message, how much big the message is, then wait list. So, like if this is first in first out and you have inserted around 8 messages, so last message will have a waiting list number of 8 because first all the seven messages has to be delivered, and then only the number of eight message will come. So the wait list is there. Now you can see this. There are some APIs for message queues like MSG GET. MSG here means message. GET means get. Okay, message get means to. It's like initializing the message queue. Okay, you are initializing it. You are trying to start the communication. You are trying to start the communication. So, message get is an API. So. You can understand it like a function. It is just like a function. You can use that function to open message queue. This is directly used in C language. Okay. Then again, message ascending is send. Okay. You're sending some data into the message queue. Okay. So of course, there will be different parameters to whom you have to send, to whom, from where you have to send, what are the length you have to send. So I have not provided the parameters, but this is one more function, message send. Then again, there is message receive. RCV means receive. You can receive some message, and then message CTL, message control. You can see queue consists of control blocks. Okay, so if you have to, you have to access some control things. If you are giving some message which at the end controls the process, so for that you can use message control. So there will be different parameters of each and every function, but the basic idea behind all these functions are to do the communication. Okay, and all these things are written in C language. These all functions are in C. Okay, now again, there are one more inter-process communication, that is pipes. Okay, am I going too fast? Is everybody understanding what I'm speaking?
Yes, sir.
So I'm curious, no one is having any doubts.
Yes, sir.
Am I teaching very good or you are not understanding at all?
No, sir, you are understanding it.
Okay, great. Good. So pipes. So pipes is also a inter-process communication. So it is like a circular buffer allowing two processes to communicate. So you can understand pipes like circular linked list. Okay, you can visualize pipes as circular linked list. It is not completely equal to circular linked list, but for the analogy purpose, you can understand pipes as circular linked list. Okay, and it allows two processes to communicate with each other. The only work of pipes is, suppose you have a bucket, okay, and you have a pipe connected to your tap. What will, and if you open the tap, what will it happen? What will happen? The water from the tap will go to the bucket. That's the only thing that pipe can do, right? It can communicate the data from pipe to the bucket. Similarly, here pipes work is same. It has, its work is to communicate between two processes. So, and the communication takes place in FIFO mechanism. So for, you can see here, for message queue, you can use FIFO, LIFO, PRI. Mailboxes, you have indirect addressing. In pipes, only first in first round mechanism can be used. You cannot use LIFO. If you use LIFO, it is not pipe. First in first round, you can understand it by the analogy of pipes. Okay. The first water droplet that comes, goes into the bucket. That's why it is known as pipe, right? So for pipes, first in first round mechanism can only be used. And it is mutual exclusion. Now, what does mutual exclusion means? At a time, only two processes can communicate with each other. No other processes can interfere with each other. After that, after the whole communication is completed, then the processes can switch each other. Contact switching can take place, but when the communication is happening, only two processes can communicate with each other and there can be no interference between them. So that is the meaning of mutual exclusion. Then again, write into pipe only if space is available. Now, for example, your pipe is of 8 bytes. So you cannot write 9 bytes into pipe. Okay. for example, you're 8 bytes and you have occupied around 6 bytes, only 2 bytes of field, and you are sending 3 bytes of data. You cannot do that, right? So this is very important concept. If you are writing C code, you have to put a condition. So if you can only write into pipes when data is available. So it looks a very silly concept. You can write to the you can write only if data is available. But you may think it is a silly concept, but it is not. Why? Because sometimes communication happens so fast that there is a chance, even if spaces are available for 8 bytes, you are transmitting 9 bytes. So there are so you have to put some delay between communication so that the hardware has enough time to accumulate all the messages. Okay, so this is very important thing. So don't neglect it, that write into pipes only if space is available. So if you are writing a C code, this has to be an error handler has to be written if this condition fails. And again, read from the pipe if data is added. Now, if suppose you have 8 bytes, only 6 bytes are full, and you want to access seventh position, so you will get a garbage value. You will not get correct value. So you should read from the data only if data is available. Else you cannot read the data. So even if you write code in C language, you have to write an error handler for this also, that only data can be accessed or read when data is available. So this is basic pipes. It's very easy. Directly understand it using your normal tab to pipe to bucket. So it's easier than. Now this, there are two. So right now I was doing IPC, right? Pipes, message queues, mailboxes. These are IPCs, inter-process communication. Before this, it was mutexes and semaphores. This is for task scheduling. Okay, this is for task scheduling. How you can handle the task so that error doesn't happen. So suppose you don't use semaphores and mutexes. What happens? So there are two processes, right? Process one and process two, and there is a display. And suppose you're trying to display simultaneously process one and process two. What will happen? The display unit will not understand to whom they need to display. Display one, process one or process two. And there will be chances that process one and process two will overlap each other, and you will get a different result which you are not desired. It's a basic example, right? So to solve these small issues, semaphores and mutexes are used. Before that, we were looking into process and threads. So what are actually processes? Okay, and then before that, we will look into process states, what process states are. Now, with these all concepts, we are looking into two main concepts, that is starvation and deadlocks. This starvation and deadlock is little complex, and I want your full attention right now. IPC was easy, so it was okay. So semaphores, process states, semaphores, mutex, starvation and deadlock. These are very important topics, and I really want you to have full focus right now. Okay. Now, what is starvation? A situation in which process is overlooked by the scheduler. Now, suppose there are three processes. One of the processes is overlooked. The scheduler don't even give the access of the processor to the process two. Now, that is a very bad scenario. Because you have to write code so that this starvation does not happen. So we will look into depth. What happens in starvation? Okay. Suppose there are three processes, P1, P2, and P3, and it requires to access resource R. Okay. P1 has access to the R and P2 and P3 are ready. So you understand this thing that I will again go into what I can say notepad. So there are three processes. Okay, and all the three processes need to have this resource. Okay, now suppose P1 have the access of this resource. Okay, and P1 is continuing his process and it is trying to complete that process, and in between context switching happened, maybe due to priority, maybe due to time lock. Okay, and P3 gets resource. Okay, now P3 is again doing its work, and when P3 is doing its work, in P3 there is a condition in which P3 has to send the resource to P1. So P3 is sending resource to P1. Okay. Then again, P1 is accessing the resource, and again, due to again context switching happened, and again, same process is complete. Same process continues. And P3 is given the resource, and again P3 is sending resource to P1. So this process is keep on continuing, and our P2 is not getting the resource. P2 is not getting the resource. So this is starvation. P2 is starvated. It is P2 is not given the access to the processor, and this is a very bad phenomenon. Okay, this is a very bad phenomenon. So look at this. P1, P2, P3 is required to access resource. P1 has access, and P2 and P3 are waiting. After P1 completes the process, P3 is given access. But again, P1 requires the resource R, and P2 will be denied access. So this process keeps on continuing, and P2 is denied access, and P2 cannot access this resource. But this is basic method. This starvation, and how to remove it? There are a lot of mechanism, and this is out of this scope. How to remove it? There are a lot of things that needs to understand how to remove starvation. One of the things in mutexes and semaphores. Yes, mutexes and semaphores can be used. There are many like wrong robin mechanism. Like I told you, this. Time quantum. Okay, this time quantum can be used to remove starvation. What will happen? Suppose after few milliseconds, the processor has to switch. Even if process one needs to use the processor will switch. It does not matter to processor. So in that scenario also, P1, P2, and P3 will get the access. So these are some few methods, but to remove starvation, there are a lot of methods that can be used. Okay, so this is starvation, and there is one more concept, that is deadlocks, which is similar to starvation. Okay, so suppose there are two or more processes that are waiting for each other to release the resource. So, for example, again, I will go to our notepad. Okay. So, P1 and P2 are two processes, and there are two resources, R1 and R2. Okay. P1 gets R1. P1 gets the resource R1. Now, one more thing. P1 and P2 requires both resource, R1 and R2. It's not that P1 only requires R1. P1 requires both R1 and R2. P2 also requires both R1 and R2. But right now, P1 gets the resource R1. And now, and P2 gets the resource R2. And P1 is waiting for P2 to release R2, and P2 is waiting for P1 to release R1. So, yes, you're getting this point. P1 is waiting for P2 to release R2, and P2 is waiting for P1 to release R1. And both P1 and P2, both ghamandi hai, they are not releasing each other's, they are not releasing R1 and R2. Okay, they are not releasing their individual resources. They want the other resource, but they are not releasing their individual resources. So this is deadlock, because these both processes are dead. They cannot move ahead. For completion of the processes, both process requires both resources, R1 and R2. But they are getting only one resource. So these both processes cannot be completed, and this is known as deadlock. So when two processes or more processes are waiting for each other to release resource, P1 and P2 process requires R1 and R2 resource, and each process is waiting for other resource. So this is deadlock, where both the processes cannot work. So again, if you're writing an RTOS in C language, you have to make sure it is free from starvation, it is free from deadlocks. For deadlocks also, you can use mutexes, you can use semaphores, you can use time quantum, you can use priority mechanism, you can use round robin mechanism, fixed priority mechanism. There are a lot of mechanisms available. Every mechanism has their advantages and their disadvantages. For particular application, for particular usage, you can use only that type of scheduling mechanism. For some other, you have different scheduling mechanisms. But in the end, you use any scheduling mechanism, three things has to be maintained. If it is hard, RTOS, time constraint should be maintained, and it should be free from starvation and deadlocks. These are the three things. These three things are the pillar for RTOS. Without that, RTOS will not work. So this is what my whole session is all about. And I took around 1 hour. So still, if there are any doubts, anything you want to ask, anything, anyone, anything regarding embedded system, regarding RTOS, you can ask. If there are any doubts in any slides, you can ask me. So this is right time to ask any doubts. Okay. Come on, everyone. What I can see, there are around 37 people out of the world. So, hum hai tu, Aarti, Telakul, Sumit, Rashmi, Rohan, Nikita. Anyone, any doubt? See, I know there has to be some doubts. That's not possible, right? How there are no doubts? Anyone?
If you understood everything, students, you can write in chat box, or you can unmute your device and you can give answer. Yes. Yes, any query from your side, students? Neil sir, could you give us brief idea about scheduling algorithms, round robin, with priority?
Okay, fine.
Using a scheduling algorithm in company. So how they are used to write programs, since what are the benefits of those?
So I will tell you two, like round robin. So for example, round robin is simple. For example, there are, is my screen visible?
No, sir.
No. Okay. So round robin, suppose there are process 1, process 2, process 3, process 4. So round robin mechanism are simple. So there are time span is provided. For example, time span is 200 milliseconds. Okay. So the processor will first work on P1 for 200 milliseconds. If it can complete P1, well and good. If it cannot complete P1, it will move to P2. Then again, it will work to P2 till 200 milliseconds. If it can complete, well and good, else it will move to P3. And similarly, if it cannot complete P3, it will move to P4. And then from P4, again, everything will go back to P1. So this is round robin mechanism. And suppose P2 is completed. So now P1 will go to P3. So, but this all thing works in time span. Like after 200 milliseconds, context switching has to happen. All the data will be saved in stack. All the data will be saved in all. Suppose P1 needs to access some registers. And what it will do, after 200 milliseconds, the registers values are changed. Then it will save that register value into stack. And then context switching happen. And then the processor will move to P2. And corresponding context switching happen. And this is what round robin mechanism. This is very common mechanism. Second one is fixed priority. Now suppose there are P1 to P3. And you say P2 has highest priority. So first, then after P2, what, which has highest priority? Suppose P1. So first P2 will be completed thoroughly, then P1, then P3. But fixed priority mechanism is generally not used right now because there are a lot of, suppose P2 requires a lot of time. Okay. Then P1 and P3 processes which requires very less time to complete it will be, it has to be delayed for a long amount of time, right? But that is removed in round robin mechanism. So round robin, so these are some basic mechanism techniques which is used in industry. So anything more, anything regarding embedded systems? Do you want to ask how to get into embedded systems? What are the benefits of getting into embedded systems? What you need to study to get into embedded systems? Anyone? If there are any doubts, I'm again asking you. So see, when you start doing your job, then at that time you will realize that you should ask doubts. At present, when I was at your age, I was in same conditions that I don't ask doubts. I used to sit mute. But when I'm at present situation, I think that was my biggest mistake. You should really ask doubts. There's nothing, no one is going to think that you have asked a stupid doubt or anything. It's more important that you understand. Everyone is for their own self. Okay, so it's important that you understand your own concepts completely.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Yes, sir, my topic is not deeply related to the subject. I just wanted, you mentioned that the Python language cannot be used for this type, right?
Yeah.
So my question is like, now technology is moving forward and in most of the systems, Python is used. So you don't you think that Python should be used for the system to make work easier?
Okay, so see, the statement which I said that Python cannot be used in embedded systems, that is not completely true. So, for example, if you use Raspberry Pi, you use Python there, right? But what happens, the problem with Python is Python cannot access memory. So there are Python cannot access memory. You have nothing related to memory. It is very high level language. It's way too high level language. And there are a lot of layers inside the Python language. Okay. What happens with C? C is a middle level language. It is not high level. It is not low level. Low level means assembly. It is neither assembly. It is not high level like Python. So you can even access the memory. So yes, what you said that Python makes the work easier, but I will give you a scenario. The operating system that you are using, Windows 10, is written in C language or a subsidiary of C language. It is not written in Python. So why it is written in C language or C++, not in Python? You can go and check into Google. In fact, if you remember Windows XP, it was completely written in C language, completely. From Windows 7, they started using subsidiaries of C language. Okay. So even today, C languages are used to write operating systems and all those things. And if Python will make works easy, then why operating systems are not written in Python? Because there are some things that Python cannot give you. Python cannot give you memory allocation. Python cannot give you dynamic memory allocation. Python cannot give you access to RAM. Python cannot give you access to ROM. Python cannot give you access to device drivers. Python cannot give you access to each and every bit that you're sending. But C can give you access to each and every bit. At the end, what computer does the communication in ones and zeros, logic one and logic zero. C language can change even single bit, which is not possible in Python. And that is why even in core embedded, Python is not used. Personally, if you ask me, I still, I don't like Python language. It is, personally, it's my personal opinion. Python is very good for machine learning, artificial intelligence, because there are a lot of libraries available. But in embedded systems, it's very rare. It's very rare you use Python, very rare. It's like 70% C language, 20-25% C++, 5% other languages like Java, C#, SQL or Python, JavaScript. JavaScript is used, but it is 70% dominated by C language. So is this clear your doubt?
Anything yes, more? Sir, yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So do you like Python language, right? You like Python?
Yes, like we have just started it. We have not learned deep anything, but few things
so
we know
it,
about.
Yeah, so if you are interested in Python, then you should move towards machine learning and artificial intelligence. In embedded systems, it is mainly C language, C and C++. Yeah. Anyone? Okay. Anything more? Yeah. Thank you for asking question, Prashit. I hope I am pronouncing it right. Prashit, right?
Yes,
Prashit,
yes.
Gujar.
Yeah. Yes.
So thank you for asking question. So
thank you, sir.
Anyone wants to ask anything? I think Shubhangi ma'am, we should conclude.
Yes,
no one
sir.
Is asking anything.
Yes, sir. They must be understood everything, sir. That's why they are not asking. You have really taken very good session, sir.
Thank you.
Now, I would like.
Maybe they have not understood anything. That can be also a scenario.
From my view, sir, they must be understood. Soham, now I would like to request Soham to give a vote of thanks.
Yes, ma'am. So good morning, everyone. I am Master Soham Mithul, convener of Pune CWIT IEI Students Chapter and student of third year NTC. Would like to present a vote of thanks to our today's expert speaker, Mr. Neil Madhav, sir. Associate Embedded Engineer from Intel or Systems Private Limited Pune, for enlightening us with their knowledge in the fields of embedded and RTOS concepts in this expert lecture. Your knowledge regarding RTOS, kernels, semaphores, mutex, threads, and many more concepts was very helpful for all of us, and we are sure that all of us will implement this in our future. Once again, I would like to thank you, sir, for sharing your expert knowledge with all of us. And also a special thanks to Shubhangi ma'am and AS Tandak sir for giving us an opportunity to arrange this expert lecture under Pune CWIT IEI Students Chapter. Thank you. Stay home, stay safe.
Thank you, Soham. And Soham, you can also give your feedback. Have you understood all concepts?
Yes, ma'am. These were totally new concepts, but I have understood all those. Yes.
Thank you, Soham. Thank you.
Thank you, Neil sir. So we will stop here. And yes. Now, students, you can join a further lecture. Okay. Everybody, stay home and stay safe. Stay healthy.
Okay. Thank you, Shubhangi ma'am, for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, and all of you, all the best for your career. And study well, okay. And stay safe with COVID, okay. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So